Welcome to the show, André. It's great to have you and excited to talk today.
Hi, Avi. Thanks for having me.
I'm excited to speak to you because you have a bunch of research out there on developer productivity. One more recent piece that you wrote was in this Springer book, and it was titled Developers Diverging Perceptions of Productivity. And it was sort of like a meta-analysis of a bunch of research you've done on developer productivity. Tell me more about the sort of impetus or driving reason for creating this paper in the first place.
Yeah, sure. So this chapter is actually a result of a workshop that we had in a castle in beautiful Germany in Dachstuhl, where researchers met together to talk about developer productivity. Back then, we were basically working with the motivation from a famous quote from Mark Anderson, software is eating the world. And this was kind of the motivation because it shows pretty well how the increasing demand for software is outpaced by the supply. And to sort of still the world's hunger for software, we sort of need to help companies and organizations to enhance productivity of their developers and also make this sort of concrete, which is why we in the end decided to write a book on different forms of productivity, different perspectives, even different approaches, and then publish it openly so everybody could download it and benefit from it. And what we did basically is we summarized some of the original work that we did on software developers' perceptions of productivity. And I mean my co-authors, Gail Murphy from the University of British Columbia, Thomas Zimmermann from Microsoft Research, and Thomas Fritz from the University of Zurich. Thomas Fritz was also my supervisor during my PhD. And what we asked ourselves basically is, what does it really mean for a developer to be productive? What does productivity mean in the context of software development? And the challenge that we faced is, or what we found is that there is a whole bunch of research that looked into productivity from a top-down perspective, basically from like a managerial point of view. And they would try to quantify and measure productivity with things such as the number of work items completed per month or the function points completed per day in like older research, or even the lines of code a developer can complete per hour. And this sounds crazy, but this is something that research initially looked into, but also we saw that companies apply that. And the problem is that some of these productivity measures are really output driven. They look at artifacts or code created per some unit of time. And what is missing in this perspective is the developer's individual perspective on productivity, depending on their work roles and practices, how experienced they are, the tools they use, the teamwork they have, and so on. And this was really the basis for our research, and our goal was to better understand these individual and more social factors that affect developer productivity. And obviously, in some cases, this can even be a feeling, which is quite hard to quantify.
Well, thanks for that intro. And you mentioned this group met at a castle. tell me more about that. Like, who was there? Who was part of this mastermind group and who organized it?
If I recall correctly, the organizers were a couple of researchers, actually Gail Murphy, whom I've mentioned, and also Gloria Mark. She is in Los Angeles. She's also quite famous in her for her research on interruptions and context that developers and other knowledge workers work in as well. And what they basically did is they invited researchers in the field, but also a few practitioners, for example, from Google and Microsoft, to join there for a couple of days. And Dachstuhl is basically this very, very remote village, which has a very old, couple of hundred years old castle. And the idea is that everybody goes away from their daily work, can relax a bit. So we also did many walk meetings, for example, had fun activities. And then during the days, we usually had workshops where we would talk about each other's research and then set specific goals for the next couple of days during that week. And in our case, it was to come up with a rough outline of such a book that could be valuable to not just researchers, but also practitioners.
Well, I love that. And sort of bringing research to practitioners is why we're here today. So excited to dive in further. You mentioned you'd looked at a bunch of research you'd done over the years in writing this chapter. So you've been working in research in this area for a long time. Can you sort of describe the journey you've gone on? You know, what's been the evolution of your own research, and are you done yet, or are you still kind of trying to answer big, hairy questions?
I think a researcher is never done with his or her research. That's what it makes it exciting. There is always something new to explore and find out. This research actually started in my bachelor's when our idea was to... So back then, it was sort of cool to own a Fitbit. This was a time where Fitbit and slowly even Apple Watches and so on were becoming more modern and fancy and hip. And we sort of thought it would be cool to create something like the Fitbit, which is successful at like motivating people to develop more healthy lifestyles, to develop something like that, but for developers, and give them insights into their own work habits, work practices, what makes them productive, what prevents them from being productive. And we sort of wanted to build such a self-monitoring tool. And very quickly we realized, what we really don't know yet is what do developers actually want to know about their work. And then we started to try to better understand how developers define their productivity. And very, very quickly we learned that it's really, really individual. And this depends a lot on their culture, the company's culture, and also their personal thinking about productivity and the concept behind it. So this is sort of where we started to divert a bit into the space of trying to better understand how a developer, I'm not a manager, how a developer defines productivity, and also what inhibits them and prevents them from working productively.
One of the things that stood out for me in your chapter was you mentioned you looked at how developers spend their time at work. And you said you found that developers spend about a quarter of their time with coding-related activities and a quarter of their time with collaboration activities. Were you surprised by that when you found that? Or was that aligned with sort of what you had anticipated?
No, we were actually quite surprised by that. We would have thought that developers spend most of their time or the majority of their time with coding, or at least with coding-related activities, so including like debugging and testing and so on. But it turned out that at least in the companies whom we have observed and studied, this was not the case, or this was very, very rarely the case. And the reason is that there are so many other things to development work that many people are not aware of. And one challenge is that when we think about productivity in this more traditional way or managerial point of view, we say, hey, a developer is really productive if he or she can complete many work items, can actually get their stuff done, but they can only spend so much time or something like a fourth of their time with actual coding. And everything else is collaboration, planning, reading, writing documents, web browsing, and also sometimes just thinking about the problems.
And I'm curious, how did this relate to the developers' perceptions of their productivity? Did they consider this time spent on collaborative activities to be productive, or did they consider that to be like non-productive time of their own?
This depended a lot on the person, on the culture, and so on. But meetings, for example, were the most controversial activity. Some developers mentioned that this is by far the worst way to spend their time. Even more than half of the developers mentioned that they would consider meetings as unproductive. And the reason for that sort of is, on the one hand, that oftentimes meetings are not very well organized. They don't have clear goals. They lack an outcome, or they have too many attendees. But also on the other hand, one big problem is that if it's not the developers who plan the meetings are scattered all over the day. And in between meetings, they sometimes have half an hour or an hour to work on. And as a developer, it often takes some time to actually dive into work and get into this sort of flow and focus. And if after half an hour, they already have to jump into another meeting, or if they are interrupted by someone else, they never really get into this flow state where they can actually make progress on their tasks and also focus properly in order to also avoid making mistakes and so on.
Well, that's a really interesting point you bring up about meetings, because it's true. So two people can be in the same meeting but have very vastly different impressions or experiences with it. I'm curious, in the chapter you wrote that these observations suggest, you said that measures or models that attempt to quantify productivity should take individual differences, such as the context of a developer's workday, into account. I'm curious, how would you sort of propose that be done, particularly when, like you described, different developers can have totally different perceptions of the same activities, such as meetings?
You mean the way of how to sort of quantify productivity?
Yeah, I would just love if you could just elaborate on that line from the chapter, right, around needing measures or models that attempt to quantify productivity through individual differences.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think one challenge is that most of us sort of think that there will be this ideal and perfect measure to sort of quantify productivity. And it will actually be useful to have something like that, because then we can also measure the improvements that we make or the different types of changes that we make in a team, in a company, and see if it actually has some sort of impact and improvement. And from the findings that we made in our research, it sort of indicated how difficult it will be to find a good measure or even a combination of measures that is fair and even sort of correct. And the easiest thing would basically be to say, okay, let's just not measure productivity at all. Let's not quantify it. Because if it's wrong, it can cause stress. People would probably even start to game the measures and so on. But on the other hand, companies and especially managers and team leads need some way of knowing if they're heading in the right direction. And one thing that we found from talking to developers, which can be valuable when still trying to come up with measures, is to not just try to have a single one and try to use that one and apply it to every single team and every part of the company, but try to talk to developers and include developers in the process of looking at what could be certain things that are actually measurable that sort of help to quantify your progress and your productivity and if you spend your time well. And I think it's also important to be really, really transparent about what is being measured and why and who has access to that. And I think the most crucial part would also be to not only rely on measurements, but also rely on developers' self-reports. And I think that's also something where the axe is going into, where you want to try to change something and then ask people for their feedback. And based on their feedback, which could be regular self-reports once a month or once a day or once a quarter, depending on the topic, you still get sort of get trends and can learn from developers. And I feel like including them into this process is really crucial. And I think then it might be possible to define sort of certain measures to quantify productivity that are still sort of fair and also well accepted within the team, and maybe even across teams and companies.
Well, I love that advice on sort of how to approach measuring developer productivity in the workplace. I'm curious, in your chapter, you mentioned sort of previous studies where you've looked at the fragmentation of a developer's workday, and you mentioned that you found that developers switch tasks on average 13 times an hour, but that interruptions from coworkers were the most costly context switches. Could you just explain a little bit more of the research behind this and what you found?
Sure, yeah. This was actually conducted during a study where we also were looking into how developers spent their time at work. And since nobody really did that before, the first thing that we did is I sat behind 20, 30 developers for a couple of hours and just observed what they were doing. This was kind of interesting because for a while they were also, it felt weird for them to be observed during work and having some person sitting behind them. But after a while, they actually forgot about me and then they would just start to work on their tasks and on their regular work as they would usually do. And one thing we noticed there was really, as you mentioned, that how often and frequently they were switching contexts and tasks. And not all of the context switches are bad, obviously, but some of them, especially when they are interrupted at a time when they're really, really focused, they can be very inhibitive of being productive. And then even resuming such an interruption comes at a high cost, because developers usually create their mental model of a task, think about it, and then without any notice, somebody drops in and says, "Hey, did you watch that game yesterday? What did you think about it?" And then developers basically switch to a completely different topic, talk about it for a few minutes, maybe half an hour, and when they actually come back to work, they have to remember where they were, what they were thinking about, what this concrete line of code they were just looking at was about, or why they have this particular Stack Overflow web page open and what they were thinking at the time. And so we started to look into how can we support developers to work, to reduce interruptions, to foster flow. And one way to do that is by increasing everyone's awareness about interruptions and the cost of interruptions, which could help to reduce fragmentation in the end.
Thanks for explaining that. That's really interesting. I want to move on to a different part of the chapter where you talked about the characterization of developers into these different groups based on how they perceive their productivity. We don't have to go through all the groups in this interview, but I'm curious, how did you actually identify those groups?
So far, and also what we talked about in this podcast so far, we were only looking into individual developers' perceptions of productivity. And this is useful and helpful in a small team where you can ask everyone and then sort of better understand what makes them productive, what doesn't, and so on. But it's very challenging to sort of determine any meaningful actions that could help increase productivity on like a team level or an organizational level. So we were really curious to understand, are there any commonalities in how developers perceive their productivity? Can we sort of group developers with similar perceptions together? And one thing we did is we sort of looked at developers' productivity and how it changes over the day. And in that study, we basically asked developers once an hour to self-report their productivity on like a scale from 1 to 7. And this was just a small pop-up that they would see. And then we visualized that and compared the different visualizations from the different developers. And what we found there is that you can group developers' perceptions of productivity over the day into three groups, roughly. And they are quite similar to their circadian rhythms. So there is like this morning person and this afternoon person type. And then there is a person who is, we called low at lunch person. The morning person is kind of rare in our sample. So about 20% of all developers could be classified into such a group. And those are the people who are very productive early in the day. So they might even come a bit earlier, or they would start their work from home very early in the day. And those are the developers who really don't want to have any meetings in the mornings, because that's when they feel most productive. That's when they want to get their stuff done. And then on the other hand, there are the afternoon person group, which is the largest group by like 30%. They feel most productive in the afternoon, sometimes even stay longer. And those are the ones who actually want to have meetings in the mornings, because then they can set up their day, they can exchange ideas, and then in the afternoon really get their stuff done. And you already see sort of this mismatch of how people want to structure and organize their days. And what was really interesting is when we looked at every developer individually, you could actually see that for an individual developer, they always had about the same patterns. So they basically follow some habitual patterns each day. So this particular developer really is an afternoon person, and in most cases feels more productive in the afternoon. This was this one type of work where we try to cluster developers. And another one was where we asked developers to sort of talk about and describe what makes a day productive and unproductive. And we gave them a list of like factors that could potentially impact productivity. And we clustered all those responses into six groups. So we identified that there are people who we deemed the social developer or the lone developer. And they are sort of interrelated. So the social developers, they really love to collaborate. That's what they think makes them productive. They also love to do code reviews, for example, or helping others. And when they want to get stuff done, they usually come to work a bit early, and that's the most quiet time in the office. And then on the contrary, the lone developer really tries to avoid any kind of disruption. He's probably a bit more introverted, and also experiences reduced productivity when there is, for example, background noise in the office, or when they have to do a lot of active collaboration in like an asynchronous way. And what is interesting is that most of the developers can belong to one or multiple of this group. So we also found this balanced developer who can handle interruptions, for example, really, really well. This is a group which is rather small and not very large, but there are people who can just easily deal with that.
Yeah, I love that advice and those observations. I'm curious, what advice then would you have for developers or managers? Like, what can they do with this information?
What I would recommend to do is to talk to your team members or to the different teams that you have, and try to identify to which of these groups and types of developers, based on their perceptions, they fit into. And the details in those groups or like the characteristics of those groups can then help to better understand how to actually match the people or match the different groups. And I already mentioned one challenge where you have like the social developer and the lone developer. And you as a manager, I think you sort of, or even a team lead, you sort of have to find a balance of, for example, when do you actually have synchronous communication? When do teams meet? Is this during a time where always this one group feels more productive and this other group is less productive? Or can you actually find an overlap where everybody doesn't really want to focus on code, but where it's okay to actually meet? And it's interesting because we've noticed that most of these characteristics of developers and the individual impacts of the different factors and how they influence your own productivity, this is not something that teams and managers and individuals ever think about and consider. So initiating discussions about what makes you productive and what doesn't, I think would be a great start. And then sort of work with these individual differences and just accept that there is not really a one fits all solution. I think it's easier to help teams to improve their own productivity themselves, at least if you consider the topic from a work habits perspective.
That's really fascinating. I'm curious, you know, how can this impact then how teams and organizations kind of design how they work, right? I'm curious, have any sort of best practices emerged based on your research, or at least perspectives you may have on how, you know, teams should be working based on what you've learned from this research?
Sure. Yeah, I think there is not really something that will work for everyone. So teams will need to understand how everybody wants to work and what makes them more productive and what is useful. But there are certain topics that they can consider and that they should probably talk about and discuss. And one of them I already mentioned are meetings and when people meet, how frequently they meet, if they use synchronous or asynchronous ways. One thing that works very well, and I think more and more companies are applying, for example, are meeting-free days, where they say on Mondays, everybody can just work on their stuff. They can also work whenever they want to. So if I'm a developer who likes to work in the evenings or late nights, then I can just do that because I don't have to work synchronously with someone else. Another thing that works really well is to help developers to sort of schedule focused work blocks. This is something that everybody can do for themselves when they think about which are the times when I can work very productively, when I can very quickly get into the flow and focus. And then I can basically add a 1 or 2 hour block to their calendar. And nobody else hopefully should or would add a meeting request to the time.
Well, appreciate those tips. I'm curious, so you, in 2014, you published this paper on software developers' perceptions of productivity. In 2017, you had two papers published, one on sort of activity context switches, and then the characterization of different perceptions of productivity. Where's your research? What's next? Where's your research focused on now?
Yeah, that's a great question. So as you mentioned, so my initial work with those couple of papers was really on understanding how developers spend their time, what influences their work, their productivity, and so on. And afterwards, we started to look into approaches that we can develop to help them foster flow and productive work and so on. One thing that we did is we created a self-monitoring tool, which is similar to, for example, rescue time, which in the background non-intrusively collects all kinds of data such as meetings, program usage, emails, websites, files, and so on, and then visualizes everything on a timeline. And this basically helps people to try to better understand how they're spending their time. And paired with the self-reports on productivity once an hour, you could even create simple correlations on that and then better realize which days you're more productive or which times of the day or with which activities. But we learned that the insights were interesting to people, but they were not really actionable. It is really, really difficult for developers to really know how to change things. But they still learned a few things. So for example, one thing that was funny was that one developer mentioned that he realized through the study he's interrupted every few minutes by an email notification. And he just realized in the study that he could just disable it and this interruption is gone. Sometimes it's the simple things that can already have some impact and have some positive impact. What we followed up on with that research then is we tried to come up with a list of goals that developers might have for their work habits. So not really thinking about what is the most productive and best framework or cloud service or laptop, but thinking more about when do I work productively? What makes me more productive? How do I want to be as a developer? Do I want to be someone who actually helps each other, who does code reviews? Or am I always the one who just codes on my own stuff and feels productive like that? And we there developed sort of a reflective goal setting approach where in the morning we would ask developers, what is your plan for today? What do you want to make progress on? And then in the evening we ask them, did you actually make progress on that? What happened? What was this productive or not? And on a good day we ask them, hey, what do you want to do tomorrow to have another good day? And on a bad day we ask them, what could you change tomorrow to actually reduce this thing that made you less productive or made you make less progress? And what was really interesting is initially I had a hard time to actually recruit participants because every developer said, like, I don't want to do a diary study. That's not something I will do. And I don't want to report all of that once a day. And towards the end of the study, they realized that just thinking about those things and being prompted for like a week or two about those topics increased their awareness about the work habits so much that this was very valuable. And we had this famous quote that we added to the paper, which was like, thanks for enforcing me to think about my work and to reflect about it. The study itself was actually something like a tool. And I think this also sort of goes into the direction of DX, where you ask developers to reflect about the different factors that could impact their productivity, but also experience. And I think for me, as like this summary of this part of my research, it's really about, it's so individual how developers feel about productivity and what impacts it. So you have to sort of include those individual perspectives. And an easy way to do that is by using self-reports. And you don't need to ask them every day forever to self-report, but this can be for a week or two, and then again occasionally. And it's already very valuable and can lead to a lot of insights also for team leads.
That makes sense. Well, looking forward to following your future research. I'm curious, any recommendations, any other research going on in this space that you're excited about or following?
Yeah, I think what is one thing that is being worked on more and more is creating actual tools. And researchers are trying to create tools that also have a more direct impact in industry. One thing that we did, for example, is we created the flow light. The flow light is like a physical small traffic light, which visualizes a person's focus. So if it's red, it will visualize to everyone in the office that this person is currently focused and should not be interrupted. And if it's green, people can interrupt. And this very, very simple approach was actually quite successful, not only with reducing interruptions, but also with increasing awareness. And this is an area I see more and more work going into. So creating very simple tools that help people to increase their awareness about those topics. There is not really a very simple way to do it, which is why you have to do this iteratively, basically. And I think this is an exciting thing to do. And another thing, another perspective to look into is that more and more researchers are looking how can we use biometric data to better understand what is going on in a developer's body. So they would look into developer's heart rate or correlate developer's sleep with productivity. And for example, recommend developers to take a break when they are stuck or when they are stressed, or maybe to look at their code again when they had a very bad sleep and they're at high risk of doing errors and mistakes. And I think creating more actionable tools is something that is very interesting at this point and has a lot of potential.
Well, I love that. Can anyone buy a flow light?
Very soon, actually. We're working on productizing it.
That's awesome.
And you can find a link on my website and sign up to the preview, actually.
That's exciting. Well, I'll be sure to sign up. And André, thanks so much for coming on the show today. Grateful to have you on and enjoy this conversation.
Me too. Thanks a lot for having me and the great questions and conversation. Thank you, Abhi.